Chantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Liars of Nature and the Nature of Liars, Cheating and Deception in the Living World, by Lixing Sun, narrated by Jason Vu. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Chapter 1. Liar, liar everywhere. She is pregnant. Raising a child takes a lot of time and energy. Yet, she is short of both. Homeless, she has no choice but to find somebody else to take care of her baby, for free. It's not easy, but she knows how to pull it off. She scouts around and spots a cozy house in a quiet neighborhood. The young wife of the family looks caring and has just given birth to a new baby, so is a perfect choice as a surrogate. She hides herself and waits in the vicinity, keeping watch on the house. Opportunity presents itself when the new mother takes a short trip to get some food. She sneaks in and switches the baby with her own. Then, she heartlessly throws a victim's infant in a dump. What you have just heard is a cold-blooded murder case, one that takes place in nature when a female cuckoo bird sneaks her egg into a warbler's nest. The cuckoo is cheating, though the scenario doesn't quite fit Oxford English Dictionary's definition of the verb cheat, to act dishonestly or unfairly in order to gain an advantage. Cheating in humans usually involves an element of intention. In the larger biological world, however, establishing intent is neither easy nor necessary. For biologists, as long as organisms act to favor themselves at the expense of others, especially in situations when cooperation is expected, they are cheating. This book is about the behavior, evolution, and natural history of cheating. Although, in common usage, the word cheating is often interchangeable with lying and deceiving. The three words differ in connotation, nonetheless. Furthermore, lying and deceiving involve two very different biological processes, as we will unveil in the next two chapters. In light of this new insight, the word cheating refers to both lying and deceiving in the book. Cheaters are everywhere in the biological world, according to our broadened definition of cheating. Monkeys sneak around for sex. Possums, well, play possum, as they are famous for when pursued by a predator. Birds scare rivals away from contested food by crying wolf, emitting alarm calls that are normally used to warn others about an approaching predator. Amphibians and reptiles are master impostors, altering their body color to blend into their backgrounds. Stickleback fish protect their eggs and babies by misdirecting their cannibal peers away from their nests. Defenseless caterpillars ward off predators by masquerading as dangerous animals, such as snakes with big false eyes. Squids escape from predators by ejecting ink to create a smokescreen in the water. Examples of lying and deceiving behavior in animals can go on and on. What may surprise you is that cheating doesn't require a brain, or even a neuron, as many plants are cheaters as well. For example, most orchids mimic the aromas of their pollinators' food. Around 400 orchid species, however, evolved a more audacious tactic. They fool male pollinators by mimicking the smell and appearance of female insects to take advantage of eager males who seek opportunities to mate. Even more amazing, these plants can keep male pollinators aroused by preventing them from ejaculating. Thus, the unsatisfied male pollinators will keep going in search of another female, including a female apparent flower, to mate with. Since these males are highly promiscuous, they are extremely effective in spreading orchid pollen. Fungi cheat too. For example, truffles, mushroom-like species that form fruiting bodies underground, emit a steroid called androstenol that mimics the pheromone of wild boars. Androstenol is produced in the testes of adult boars and has a musty odor to the human nose. When female pigs sense the truffle aroma, they will dig exuberantly for the source. What they don't know is that they are being suckered by something bearing no resemblance to the swine view they are hoping for. The only outcome of their passionate fervor is spreading spores for the truffles. Mission accomplished for the fungi that deceive. Complex organisms such as plants and fungi cheat. So does single-celled life. A good example is the slime mold, or social amoeba, known by its scientific name, Dictyostelium discoideum, or Dicty for short. When starved, the slime mold amoeba cells gather together to form a mobile slug-like structure. The slug moves as a unit until it finds a suitable spot, and then grows into a fruiting body made of a spore-producing head mounted on a thin stalk. The entire thing is shaped like a lollipop or a maraca, a rattle-like percussion instrument popular in Latin America. Figure 1.1, which can be found in the print and ebook versions of this book. The cells in the head, which consists of 80% of all cells, will seed the next generation when food becomes plentiful again. The other 20% of the cells consigned to the stalk, however, rot away after completing their mission to raise the head so that the spores can scatter far and wide, like dandelions spreading their fluffy seeds in the wind. If you were a slime cell, where would you prefer to end up? The head or the stalk of the fruiting body? The head, of course, because only in the head do you have the opportunity to pass your genes to the next generation. If you were a cell in the stalk, your genes would be destined for an evolutionary dead end. Who in the biological world wants to be relegated to an inferior status without a chance to reproduce? Fortunately, this isn't a major issue when amoeba cells have the same genetic makeup, like identical twins. When cells share an identical set of genes, it matters little as to which cell seed the next generation. However, when a fruiting body is made of a chimera of two or more types of cells, where many of the genes are different, conflict ensues. They all compete to be part of the fertile head, rather than play a supporting role in the sterile stalk. As one might expect, different cells play dirty in order to make it into the prized head by any means necessary, including cheating. Some types of cells enabled by certain genetic mutations defraud others by sending more than their fair share of representatives to the head, a maneuver similar to political gerrymandering. Moreover, once they have made it to the head, they produce noxious chemicals to prevent latecomers from getting into the lifeboat for the next generation. Recent studies have revealed that more than 100 mutant genes are implicated in this amoeba cheating scam. Next, let's visit the bacterial world to see whether they also cheat. Bacteria are tiny. Individuals alone can't do much. Just as building the Great Wall involved hundreds of thousands of humans achieving collective bacterial tasks, such as emitting light, bioluminescence, and trapping vital elements from the environment, requires millions of bacteria working together toward a common goal. That's why bacteria often congregate to form a thin, slimy layer called biofilm in soil or water. Among their communal projects is gathering iron, an element critical for bacteria to survive. The problem they face is that iron is usually found in low concentrations in their surroundings. Because individual bacteria can't do much on their own, collecting iron is necessarily a collaborative work for the community. To coordinate their efforts, bacterial members talk with one another by releasing chemicals that signal particular genes to turn on in sync to make a family of complex compounds called siderophores. Siderophores are related to hemoglobin in our blood cells in that they can bind with iron. In this way, they serve as bacteria's fishing net to scoop up iron floating in the environment. But there is a catch. Siderophores are costly to produce for individual bacteria in terms of material and energy. Yet, they are a public good, a commons shared by all members in the community. As we all know, once you have a public good, there are often cheaters who come along for a free ride. Who hasn't been in a situation where some team members take credit for the group's work yet contribute less than other members. Bacteria also suffer from the social dilemma. There is no shortage of free riders that contribute less than their fair share to the production of siderophores, yet still devour the catch, iron, along with all the others who've done the work. Obviously, cheaters can sabotage the collective effort. If they are too numerous, productivity of siderophores will drop, and the amount of iron collected will decline, which in turn will put the livelihood of the entire community at risk. Threatened by this potentially fatal consequence, honest producers have evolved an arsenal of anti-fraud strategies. Some bacteria, for example, can band together with their genetic lookalikes to prevent free riders from infiltrating their community. They may even use toxins to kill the cheaters. Even viruses cheat. Viruses are not considered fully alive because they lack the necessary biological tools to survive and reproduce on their own. They have to steal their host's resources and genetic machinery to complete their life cycles. This means that to engage in cheating does not require a complete form of life. Blatant cases of viral cheating have been well documented. One example occurs when different viral species or different variants of the same species infect a single host cell. Their biological resources, such as genes and proteins, can become mixed. This provides opportunities for some viruses to use trickeries to steal the resources produced by others that serve as unwilling helpers. In this way, cheating viruses don't need to possess all the genes essential for making copies of themselves, or for assembling their protein coatings, known as capsids, that package their genetic material within. What we have discussed so far are cases of cheating between individuals, simple or complex, unicellular or multicellular. Cheating can also take place within the same individual. Cancer cells, for example, are cheating cells that shirk the duty of cooperation with other cells in the body. They instead gobble up all the resources, proliferate, and refuse to commit suicide when commanded to do so. Thus, fighting cancer is essentially fighting cheating cells, a point made clear in Athena Atkypissis's 2020 book, The Cheating Cell. Even inside a typical cell, cheating is part of life. For instance, the B chromosome ekes out a living by cheating, in sharp contrast to the normal A chromosomes that are familiar to us. B chromosomes are smaller and can be common, and they can be found in varying numbers within a cell. What makes them stand out is their ability to tag along without doing any work. In other words, they are passed on, generation after generation, by hitchhiking without contributing to cell functionality, akin to party crashers living on free food while enjoying themselves at their host's expense. Even genes cheat. Your body is a vessel for a vast amount of genetic garbage known as junk DNA. Just like B chromosomes, junk DNA serves no purpose for its host organism, but gets a free ride from generation to generation. The amount of junk DNA is truly awe-inspiring. It accounts for up to 98% of our genome, encompassing many varieties of useless genetic material, such as repeated elements, pseudogenes, and transposable elements, the last of which are more vividly called jumping genes. Jumping genes are fragments of DNA that can insert themselves almost anywhere in the genome through a copy and paste process, much as we do in a word processing program. They are so prolific that they make up 45% of the entire human genome. A well-known jumping gene is the AU element. With a length of about 300 base pairs, the AU element has multiplied more than a million copies of itself in the evolutionary lineage leading to humans over the last 53 million years. Today, it makes up 10.7% of the entire human genome. Because of the hyperactive nature of jumping genes and their ability to promote themselves, the genome of salamanders can be 40 times larger than that of humans. Since all animals, In fact, all eukaryotic organisms have roughly the same number of working genes. What salamanders can boast about is an extremely large genetic junkyard. As befits their name, jumping genes jump, and they jump randomly in the genome. Because the vast majority of our DNA is junk, whenever a jumping gene replicates itself and places the copy in a new location in our genome, it usually has no noticeable effect, like adding a new bag of trash in a huge landfill. But once in a while, such an insertion may hit an area in the middle of a functional gene. If this happens, it can result in a serious genetic defect and lead to health problems, such as cancer or hemophilia. Intrigued by jumping genes? There are also bizarre cases of cheating genes called selfish genetic elements, or more colorfully, outlaw genes. Among the most famous are genes known as segregation distorters, or meiotic drivers in insects. In the common lab fruit fly, Drosophila melanogaster, these genes can boost their own representation in the genome by killing sperm cells that carry alternative alleles. In doing so, these outlaw genes get more than their fair share of what would normally be an even split. If these outlaw genes are located on the X or Y chromosome, it may result in a lopsided sex ratio, more males or females, rather than a 50-50 divide. The last case of cheating genes I want to describe are known as converting elements. These genes code for enzymes called homing endonuclease, which can cut open a DNA chain at specific locations. They then add a replica of themselves into the breach. It's like a rogue physician who uses his own sperm to inseminate eggs from women who come to him seeking artificial fertilization. Converting elements commit a genetic fraud by violating the rules followed by other genes. The genes that play by the rules may be hurt directly by becoming disabled, or indirectly by being outcompeted in an unfair race. Like jumping genes, converting elements can be transmitted horizontally, copying and inserting themselves into the genome of their peers in addition to their own descendants. Unexpectedly, this rogue quality of self-promotion has given a new halo to homing endonuclease today. It's the foundation for the technology of gene editing called CRISPR, pioneered by Jennifer Doudna and Emmanuel Charpentier, who together won the 2020 Nobel Prize in Chemistry. Selfish genetic elements such as B chromosomes, jumping genes, segregation distorters, and converting elements share a common feature. They all promote their own interests at the expense of other genes. Since the transmission patterns of these genetic elements violate classical Mendelian laws, you may feel you learned the wrong things in high school biology class. But no worry, biological systems are complex and are rarely governed by universal laws as in physics. Because of this, biology is known for being a science of exceptions. The previous section, although citing only a few examples, demonstrates that cheating is found in all domains of life, at every level of the biological hierarchy, from the most complex organisms to the least sophisticated, even incomplete, forms of life. It is found among animals, plants, fungi, bacteria, viruses, chromosomes, genes, and snippets of DNA. It occurs within the same individual, between individuals of the same species, and between species that are vastly different in form and function. Regardless of their prevalence in nature, however, the words cheating, lying, and deception all come with negative connotations due to our moral preference and the premium we place on honesty. Although we value truth and loathe lies, real life often runs counter to what we ideally want. Contrary to the long-held dictum, honesty is not always the best policy in our daily lives. Consider this case. An innocent man has been falsely charged, convicted, and condemned to die. Desperate to save him, his loyal friends propose a way out: escape by bribing the jailer. Even when faced with this choice, however, he declines on the ground that to do so would be cheating the legal system. What do you think about the concept of honesty as applied by this man? If you were in his position, what would you do? If you think the man's choice is foolish, congratulations! You've just saved the life of Socrates, the Greek philosopher who chose death over breaching the trust between a citizen and the state. How likely is it that we would find a heroic martyr willing to die for the sake of trust and honesty in the natural world? Extremely unlikely. In fact, no known examples exist. On the contrary, we find that cheating is ubiquitous in nature at all levels. Why is cheating so common in the biological world? The answer: evolution is not a Socratic philosopher. It is, instead, an unmoral, heartless process that proceeds pragmatically without any concern over ethical preferences, honor codes, or value systems. It certainly makes no distinction between pro-social cooperation and anti-social manipulation, because all that matters is what works to enhance survival and reproduction. Any trait, be it morphological, physiological, behavioral, or genetic, can prevail as long as it can boost its owner's Darwinian fitness. Defined and measured as the number of offspring born and raised to adulthood. Furthermore, while freeing cheating from our moral consideration, evolution punishes those who forego it as a strategic option when using it can increase their fitness. As a result, even though it might seem brazen and despicable to our human social sensibilities, cheating thrives in the biological world. So, cheating flourishes in nature as a direct result of natural selection. Less well known, however, is that cheating also serves as a potent selective force that drives evolution on its own. The reason is simple in concept. Cheating favors the cheater and hurts the cheated. As such, it spurs the emergence of counter-cheating tactics, which in turn beget counter-counter-cheating strategies, ad infinitum. And during this ongoing evolutionary arms race, to quote Darwin, endless forms most beautiful and most wonderful have been and are being evolved. To illustrate this point, take cheating in rhizobia, soil bacteria that live in the roots of plants, specifically legumes. These bacteria fix nitrogen for plants, whereas the plants provide housing facilities and food in the form of carbon. So, the relationship is supposed to be happily mutualistic, or so we traditionally thought. But a close examination has revealed that, rather than a love affair, the relationship between rhizobia and their plant hosts is far more complicated. Some rhizobia actually produce very little nitrogen. That is, they cheat in order to get free housing and carbon from the plants. For this reason, not all plants welcome rhizobia. Some are known to fight back by cutting off the nutrient supply if cheating and rhizobia are too numerous. Only those living in poor soil, desperately in need of nitrogen, would grudgingly put up with an unfair relationship with rhizobia. Apparently, beggars can't be choosers. This demonstrates how cheating can unleash a cascade of new moves and countermoves as the bacteria and their hosts try to get the upper hand in their relationship. Intrigued by the complex strategies emerging from the evolutionary game played by rhizobia and plants? This is just a simple case to illustrate how cheating can trigger an evolutionary arms race and become a powerful catalyst for the creation of diversity, complexity, and even beauty, as we will discuss in the upcoming chapters. Unfortunately, the role of cheating in evolution remains underappreciated today for two key reasons. One is historical. Darwin himself did not address cheating as a major force in evolution by natural selection. On the Origin of Species never mentions the word cheat, but uses the word deceive 7 times. Only 3 are related to animal cheating. All are forms of mimicry, protective disguises employed by tasty bugs to fool the predators. Clearly, how cheating relates to evolution and biodiversity wasn't on his mind, at least not high in priority among his many ideas. Darwin's omission implies the second reason for us to overlook the importance of cheating. It's easy to see natural selection in terms of unrelenting, cutthroat competition for resources between rivals, or in terms of surviving the onslaughts of predators, parasites, and pathogens. Because of this, evolution has been popularly stereotyped as survival of the fittest, and nature, red in tooth and claw. Such a one-dimensional impression tends to divert our attention from the soft power of cooperative behaviors that are fully as effective for enhancing fitness in numerous situations and contexts, a point made clear by many scientists during recent decades. In some animals, social intelligence is significantly more important than physical strength. In a bonobo group, for instance, success in terms of fitness is predicated on the strength of an individual social network. A brawny brute who relies on sheer individual muscle power is destined to be a loser when faced with the united efforts of cooperating members of the group. Without some needed social intelligence, he could also become an object of manipulation, exploited by others. This is why cheating, a catalyst for social intelligence, matters so much in evolution. With the emergence of modern human intelligence, the arms race between cheating and counter-cheating strategies was not only vastly expanded and intensified, but also began to take place at a whole new level, the arena of cultural evolution. And just as it results in the emergence of novel biological traits, cheating is a potent catalytic force that spurs many cultural innovations, which then lead to cultural diversity and complexity. Without cheating, there would be no literature, art, science, technology, business, or religion. And the list goes on until it encompasses all aspects of our lives, society, and culture. This may seem deeply counterintuitive for now, but the reasons will become evident later when we zero in on how modern technologies and cultural institutions evolve and transform in sync with cheating. Despite my emphasis on the catalytic power of cheating, I have no desire or intent to create a revisionist account of the virtue of lies. On the contrary, many forms of cheating, whether or not they are considered criminal offenses, can cause substantial harm to innocent people. That's why no serious moral philosophy or religion would endorse or advocate cheating. As social scientists have amply shown us, the basic cultural glue that binds us together as a human society is trust. Though it may not seem so from what I've portrayed in this chapter, this book will reinforce this point from a biological perspective. It's unthinkable that a society could sustain itself for long without honesty and truth as its moral foundations. That's why we humans have fought so hard to suppress cheating and cheaters for millennia. Yet, despite our best efforts, cheating has been a persistent and perennial problem in all known human societies across history. No society, in fact, has ever succeeded in completely wiping it out. Moreover, as if the problem were not bad enough, cheating has become perceptibly worse in the information age. Not only do all traditional trickeries continue to exist, but cheating has extended itself into the digital realm, where it has found a fertile environment to thrive. A vast number of new scams, from phishing to sextortion, are emerging and evolving with increasing sophistication and reach. At the societal level, the ubiquity of fake news and conspiracy theories poses a major threat to democracy by preventing citizens from acquiring accurate and reliable information. It undermines our ability to agree on the basic nature of truth and fact. What should we do about cheating, given that we are unable to root it out? The seemingly quixotic and fatalistic campaign against cheating doesn't mean that it's not worth trying, nor that we're doomed to lose. Rather, it gives us an opportunity to rethink our approach in this digital age and find new ways to deal with a problem that has been with us since time immemorial. In this respect, evolutionary science can offer a trove of wisdom for us to tap into. This book will provide a tour into the world of cheaters to see how organisms use a broad spectrum of methods to deceive, hustle, and swindle others for their own gain. More importantly, we'll search for the modus operandi behind the vast diversity of tricks, scams, and frauds. We will then use our newly acquired evolutionary understanding of how cheaters operate to design novel strategies to combat cheating in our society. Specifically, we will, in the next two chapters, journey into how animals cheat by using two rules that carry through the book. We will then find reasons for how and why honesty can survive and flourish amid the onslaught of lies and deceptions in Chapter 4. With this information in mind, we will turn to Chapter 5 to see how cheating can spur the emergence of novel features, including behavior, intelligence, and art, all through evolutionary arms races. This will be followed by two chapters about human cheating and self-deception, respectively, showing that the rules used in cheating apply in both the biological realm and human cultures. Finally, we will venture into philosophical terra incognita, attempting to settle the age-old controversy. Is there any cheating that is morally acceptable? When you finish the book, I hope you'll be convinced by the book's main premise and overarching goal. Cheating is a powerful catalyst that contributes to the creation of diversity, complexity, and beauty in the biological and cultural world. By understanding how it works, cheating can be practically contained, even though it may seem like an inevitable and invincible part of life. Now, buckle up for a thrilling journey into the world of cheating. Chapter 2: Hackers and Suckers in Communication. Imagine you're a hungry crow, working hard to find a meal on a cold winter day, tired from several failed hunting trips. You fly to a tree branch to rest. Just after settling on a perch, you see dozens of your peers fighting raucously over the remains of a dead skunk on the snowy road below. You realize that you're late for the party and that the notorious corvid bully is also on the scene. What can you do to get a bite? One good solution will be to cry wolf and scare all of them away. When your rivals panic and rush for safety, you can swoop down and snatch a chunk of the skunk. That scenario is a description of crow behavior in the real world. More importantly, the scenario embodies a general rule about how animals cheat. They falsify honest information in communication for their own interest, which is the biological essence of lying. Let's add some fun and call this the first law of cheating. Yes, there is a second law of cheating to be introduced in the next chapter. Before we delve into how animals apply this law to cheat in a practical sense, we need to address a more basic issue. Why do animals cheat at all? The answer lies, paradoxically, in their need to cooperate. Cooperation is a good thing. It can allow two animals to reap greater benefits by working together rather than going it alone. The benefits of cooperation apply to all living entities, including plants, fungi, and bacteria. But our focus here is on animals. So, whenever animals intermingle, they have a strong incentive to work together. To do so, however, they need to talk, to communicate. Therefore, communication is a necessary precondition for cooperation to take place. Once communication evolved, however, theatrical drama also tagged along as an inevitable byproduct. As it takes two to tango, a basic communication loop is made of signals transmitted between a sender and a receiver. As simple as the system is, dramatic things can still happen during the process. Imagine yourself on stage as the sender. You face two options: lie or tell the truth. Whichever option you choose, you hope to gain more from your interaction with the receiver than you would by pursuing the same action alone. Otherwise, there's no reason to communicate. Producing and sending signals take time and energy. It may also draw unwanted attention from predators or parasites. When shutting up and staying put is better for you, why waste your resources and risk your life to send a message to somebody else? For the sender, therefore, to lie or not to lie is a matter of an evolutionary imperative, not a Shakespearean moral choice. To be adaptive, the sender should be a Machiavellian manipulator, unencumbered by any moral consideration. This sender as manipulator idea was championed by Richard Dawkins and John Krebs, two Oxford biologists who, in the 1970s, cut out a logical path through a jungle of muddled thoughts regarding the nature of animal communication. The theatricals don't stop after a signal is sent, of course. The receiver on the other end also faces a dilemma upon picking up a message from the sender: to respond or not to respond. What should it do? To answer this question, imagine yourself as a CEO of a widget company. One day, you receive a proposal from a potential partner, claiming that a new joint venture can raise your productivity from 2 units per hour to 3 units per hour. If you let it pass, you'll lose an opportunity to raise your profits by 50%. Yet, when you perform a risk analysis by crunching big data, it tells you that there is also a 34.21% chance that you're being scammed. If this is the case, your productivity will drop to 1 unit per hour, and your profit be cut in half. A giant loss. Should you accept the proposal or not? With the information available, you calculate that if you accept the bid, your productivity is expected to be 2.32 units per hour after factoring in the risk. This is 16% better than your current level. Although it's not the 50% increase your prospective partner claims, the increase in productivity still seems too good to pass up. In much the same way, many animals are bombarded by tempting proposals from their peers and are forced to make a choice. Although they don't produce widgets like pins, planes, or cell phone plans, they have an equally important stake on the line: their Darwinian fitness. Recall from Chapter 1 that Darwinian fitness is the number of offspring they can produce and raise to adulthood. How do they decide? Although they can't do a cost-benefit analysis by crunching numbers, they can do it by following their instincts, software implemented in their sensory and cognitive system by a powerful agent named evolution. Just as in your deciding whether to accept the unsolicited proposal for your company, animals can use their cognitive capacities to calculate potential gains and losses before they make a choice. If on average, the benefit outweighs the cost, they should respond to the signal positively. Otherwise, they'd be better off simply ignoring it. If they do so, the communication loop will collapse. The consequences of communication collapse are illustrated by a tiny critter, the Pacific field cricket. In this species, males come in two types: either honest chirpers or quiet sneakers. In their strategies for seeking mating opportunities, chirping males sing courtship songs to females, broadcasting their eagerness to mate. They do so by rubbing their serrated wings, like scraping two files against each other. Sneakers, however, have smooth wings and are unable to produce sound. So they sit near singing males and ambush females who are looking for a date. Because females prefer chirpers, they keep the population of sneaking males down to a small minority, which is only a byproduct of their occasional indiscretion. In Hawaii, where the cricket was introduced, Singing males met their nemesis, a parasitic fly that can eavesdrop on their songs to advance the fly's own interests. The female fly can locate male crickets by their chirps and lays eggs on them. After hatching, fly maggots burrow into the cricket's body and hold an extended feast on its guts until the cricket dies. On the island of Kauai, biologist Marlene Zook and her fellow researchers were stunned by the power of evolution in action. In just a decade beginning in 1991, the number of singing males took a nosedive, from abundant to extremely rare. When they dug around, however, the researchers still found quite a few crickets, but these crickets were different. Nearly all the males were mute with smooth wings. They were originally the sneakers. The honest chirpers had been decimated by the parasitic fly. As cheaters came to dominate the population, the advantage of the acoustic channel for cricket dating disappeared, the result of being hacked by a parasitic fly. This case illustrates a key point. Animal communication, as testified by its very existence, must be rooted in some fundamental level of trust among those in the loop. That is, for a communication loop to be sustained, senders must be reasonably honest, and receivers must be, on average, better off if they respond to signals rather than if they ignore them. That is why, as biologists believe, communication in animals is mostly cooperative. Cheating, by and large, is a nuisance in the overwhelming triumph of cooperation facilitated by communication. During communication between two individuals, how does lying succeed? In most situations, senders cheat by altering the meaning of their signals. That is, they falsify the message. When the intended receivers interpret a false message as being true to its literal meaning, they end up being defrauded. That's exactly how the fabled boy who cried wolf was initially able to pull off his lie. People responded as if real wolves were coming. To further illustrate the point, let's put into perspective the lying crow scenario from the beginning of the chapter. When a crow spots a stalking fox, it calls an alarm sound to its peers, alerting them, a fox is coming. The message is truthful, but if a crow makes the same call when there is no danger, the message in the signal is false. If others react as if the false message were truthful by fleeing the scene, they've been duped. Cheaters are exploiting the element of assumed honesty in communication to gain a fitness advantage. In other words, cheaters falsify truthful information to benefit themselves at the expense of their peers. This is how the first law of cheating works. In the rest of this chapter, we'll take a tour into a diverse arsenal of tactics animals use to manipulate information. Before we move on, we need to make a distinction between two kinds of communication, within species and between species. The remainder of this chapter will focus on within species communication. We'll reserve between species communication for the next chapter. When it comes to cheating, there are two key questions to ask. What do cheaters want, and how do they get it? The first is relatively easy to answer. Animals, like us, cheat in order to promote their own Darwinian fitness. That's how all organisms prosper in evolution by natural selection. Unsurprisingly, fitness enhancers, such as food, social status, and opportunities to mate, are on the most wanted list of items for which animals would cheat. The second question, how they get what they want, is more difficult to answer because, for every goal, there are multiple pathways, epitomized by the old, albeit gruesome, proverb, there's more than one way to skin a cat. Let's examine some of the details to see what patterns will emerge. Crows are far from alone in their penchant to fake alarm calls to cheat for food. Tits, flycatchers, and many other birds use the same technique. Since evolution often proceeds as an arms race, stealing food by cheating can lead to countermeasures by victims, who can also lie to protect their food. This locks victims and victimizers into an information war, where both sides try to outmaneuver the other party. Crows, ravens, and jays, for example, are always aware of their peers' presence. They often keep their distance or deliberately misdirect rivals from food sources known only to themselves. Misdirection is even more important for lower-ranking individuals. Often, it's the only option they have to protect their food. Subordinate ravens, for instance, keep the locations of food sources to themselves. When necessary, they employ tactics to trick dominant individuals, causing them to search in areas away from the subordinates' own caches of food. Only when the subordinates feel certain of a head start will they visit their secret storage to feast. But, like monkeys, ravens are too smart to be easily fooled. The misled birds can quickly figure out they've been duped and begin searching for the hidden food instead of blindly following their lying peers. Squirrels are not to be outdone by birds in devising cunning schemes to protect their food. Not only do they do most of the same things birds do, but they also take extra steps to conceal information about their food. When they're busy storing food, for instance, they keep a distance from their peers. If this is impossible, they'll turn their back toward others so as not to be caught in the act. In case others come nosing around, squirrels may fabricate fake caches as decoys to protect their food. Out of curiosity, I often watch gray squirrels hoarding acorns. However, when I go to check what they've been hiding, I often find empty hulls. I've been fooled. Similar behaviors are found in macaques, squirrel monkeys, vervet monkeys, and capuchin monkeys. These primates live in small hierarchical societies where higher-ranking members are known to rudely snatch favorite foods from those lower on the rung. To avoid this, lower-ranking members regularly withhold information about food. The same behavior has also been observed in chimpanzee groups. Lower-ranking members avoid revealing the locations of prized food, such as a hidden banana. When a higher-ranking member is around, they refuse to go anywhere near the banana unless they think it's safe. In birds and mammals, false alarms are not only used for food, they can also be used for sex. For instance, barn swallows will give off alarm calls when they spot a predator. During the breeding season, they nest together so that there are more eyes watching for predators, which benefits all the members in the colony. The downside is that a communal life also facilitates illicit affairs when neighbors live side by side, all eager to mate. In order to safeguard their paternity, to protect against infidelity by their mates, males resort to false alarms to interrupt copulation between their egg-laying partners and other males. In Formosan squirrels, females can mate with several mates during their narrow window of estrus. Males, to secure their fatherhood after mating with females, will make false alarm calls, alerting their neighbors to watch out for predators that, in reality, don't exist. While the neighbors hunker down and wait for the non-existent threat to pass, the females miss a critical moment when they might be inseminated by other males in the vicinity. False alarms, although commonly used, are far from the only trick. Cheaters have many other ruses up their sleeves, especially when sex is at stake. One particularly devious ploy is found in the Atlantic molly, a small fish. In this species, experienced males keep information about the type of female they desire, their sense of fish beauty, to themselves. They only reveal their true preference when alone with a potential mate. If another male is around, especially a young and naive one, they will mislead him by courting a female they dislike, presumably one they find bland or ugly. By using this ruse, experienced males can prevent naive males from learning what beauty consists of in their world, and therefore reduce the number of male rivals. But no other animals can outdo primates in the realm of trickery. For instance, gorillas and chimps conceal their emotional expressions by covering their face with their hands. Chimps are known to hide objects behind their backs before throwing them. That's one reason they can pose a danger to enemies, including human visitors at zoos. Also, when subordinate chimps have an erection, they turn their backs toward dominant males. Though we don't know whether they feel embarrassed, it obviously doesn't look good when your boss sees you sexually aroused. In the chimp world, this means that your presence poses a threat to the reproductive welfare of higher-ranking males, as you are now their rival in mate competition. Chimps are clearly aware of what each other think, an advanced cognitive ability known as a theory of mind. Cheating can be used as a scare tactic for female self-defense against sexual harassment from undesirable males, particularly in animals where males are bigger and stronger than females. In these species, males often harass females to get them to mate. They may even force themselves on females against their will. Females, in response, resort to a variety of tactics to fend off unwanted advances. They may appeal to dominant males for help, or stay near the preferred males for protection. But they can also resort to shrewd ruses for self-defense. One of the quirkiest tricks females use for this purpose is found in mice. Some years ago, when my colleague John Ju Jong and I were working on pheromone communication in mice, we were dumbfounded when we unexpectedly found two chemicals, 2,5-dimethylpyrazine and 4-heptanone, in the urine of females. These chemicals are typical of ferrets, the archenemy of mice. How on earth did they end up in the pee of female mice? Mulling over this surprising discovery, we came up with a hunch. Female mice might produce the chemicals to mimic the presence of ferrets, and by this ruse, they could repel unwanted males. It was like an aerosol spray we used to keep pests away. We tested the idea by exposing male mice to the chemical compounds. Indeed, they quickly retreated, apparently in fear. For quite some time after the research was completed, we were still in awe of this amazing evolutionary adaptation that enabled female mice to say,
"We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description."